Yeah,
Yeah,
first
go
of
ahead.
all, thanks to AIUS for giving me this opportunity. And I'm Dr. Abhishek from Varanasi. So let's start with the basics in traumatic cataract patient. So as we know that the traumatic cataract is one of the most common cause of unilocular vision loss in pediatric and younger age group population. We encounter these kind of patients routinely in our OPD. So depending upon the nature and the extent of injury to the lens fiber, these patients can present to us with either in the form of a very linear opacity, which is usually insignificant, or there could be a you can see here a rosette shape typical chromatic cataract, or the patient can present with a total mature cataract where the vision is highly affected. So this was a case which came to me around 2 months back, where the patient was a 9-year-old male and had a trauma with a stone 2 months back. The patient visual acuity was counting finger close to face, and you can see here the patient IOP was around 16 millimeter mercury, and the patient was on dorzolamide and timolol drops. You can see here a sphincter tear here and here, and the patient, there was a vitreous in AC. Here you can see the vitreous strand is there in the AC, and the nucleus was almost packed, and it was a total cataract with anterior capsular tear along this line. So our planning, we did the ultrasound, and the ultrasound, the posterior segment appears to be normal. So we decided to go for lens aspiration and intraocular lens 3-piece along with anterior vitrectomy under general anesthesia. So this was the procedure we did. We stained with the Trepan blue the anterior capsule to see the margins of the anterior capsule. So whether we can do the excess or not, but it was not possible because the tear was around 180 degree linear. So we started doing the aspiration of lens along with the vitrectomy cutter. This is the cutter we are using. So only we are using the aspiration mode, no cutting mode. Aspiration was around 200. So here also you can see the margin of the tear. At that time we noticed the posterior capsular tear was also present in that patient. So after aspirating the lens without cutting, after that we stained this anterior chambers with the triamcinolone acetate. Here we are putting the air bubble and then triamcinolone acetate we are injecting in the anterior chamber, and then we are cutting the anterior vitreous, which is there in the chamber, with the cutting rate around 300 and vacuum around 100. So this is, we are doing the anterior vitrectomy. You can see the one small chunk of the vitreous went inside also here, like it went down. So after completing the anterior vitrectomy, we put the 3-piece IOL in the sulcus, and then we close it. The post-operative patient vision was around 6-9 with some glasses, astigmatic glasses. So this was the, sorry. So if in a patient comes to our clinic with a history of trauma and cataract, we have to first take history, like most important 3 points: mode of the trauma, whether it was a blunt injury or a penetrating injury, is very important. Second, the object causing the trauma, what object actually caused the trauma, because in household materials like knife or all these things, or a pencil or the woods, these objects contain the fungal things. So these and their chances of fungal infection pre or post op. So considering the object is very important in the pre op and post op period. And also if you are suspecting some intraocular foreign body, like the patient had an injury with a chisel, hammer or some kind of thing. Then another third point is duration between the trauma and the presentation. Whether the duration, like the presentation, is acute, like within a few days the patient has presented to us, or it's a chronic case where the injury happened a few months back and now patient is presenting to us with the symptoms. So the first thing which comes in our mind is that whether the globe is open or closed. So first we saw the patient, and if we are suspecting that there is some open globe injury or the globe is open, maybe anterior or posterior, so first you avoid touching the object, avoid the devices which touch the eye, like the applanation tonometry or like doing syringing, etc. All these things you should avoid. Or you should also avoid the external pressure on the eye, like avoid doing ultrasound, B scan or UBM in an open eye. So now comes to the examination. Examination is broadly can be divided in two parts. Like one is structural examination, which you can do by a torch light, and you can see the overall structure of the eyelids and orbit. And then comes the functional examination, which is very important. You note down the visual acuity of the patient at the time of presentation, pupillary reaction, if it is possible, especially in cases of closed globe injury, and IOP, intraocular pressure. It could be raised, especially in cases of phacoanaphylactic or phacoantigenic kind of thing, or it could be normal, like in self-sealed wound condition, or it could be low, in especially if there is a cyclodialysis or like a ciliary shutdown type of thing. So IOP can vary depending upon the extent of injury. And ocular motility, you have to check whether there is any component of orbital fracture is also there, where the muscle is intact. So if possible, you check the ocular motility also. Then coming to the slit lamp, in the cornea, you have to basically see the two things: what is the tissue integrity and what is the tissue transparency. Both of these things are going to affect your surgical management. So first you see the tissue integrity. If there is a corneal tear, definitely you have to do a primary repair. And in the presence of a corneal tear, you should place your sutures perpendicular to the wound, and the wound margin should be exactly opposed to each other. So neither should be too tight or too loose. So this is how you should do a primary repair. And second is tissue transparency. There could be any old corneal trauma which causes the corneal opacity, or any leukomatous like a kind of adherence. So during surgery, you have to avoid these places because of the induced astigmatism and post-op difficulty in the healing issue. So avoid the existent adherence like opacity in the cornea there. And also it gives an idea about the tonicity of the trauma. So these are the two things you have to assess while preoperatively. And all these things of the corneal curvature changes, like corneal scarring, all these things affect your IOL calculation. So either you can use the other eye to plan your IOL calculation in the IOL to be placed in the traumatic eye, or you can use the average keratometry value of 44 diopter for that eye. Then coming to the anterior chamber examination. Any of this, like if there is a hyphema present, then you have to first treat it conservatively or surgically, depending upon the amount of hyphema and other things. If there is a cells or fibrin in the anterior chamber, then you have to first start the prednisolone drops and the other cycloplegic drugs, so that first the chamber is quiet, then after you can proceed for the surgery. And if there is a presence or absence of vitreous in the AC, because it gives a clue about the integrity of the jonule, and also if there could be possibility of a posterior capsular tear. And the last thing is the depth of the anterior chamber. So anterior chamber depth could be like in a deep in like a posterior dislocated lenses, or could be shallow when the lens is anteriorly subluxated. So depth of the anterior chamber is also you have to look for. Then coming to the condition of the iris, where the iris dialysis is present along with the cataract or not, that you have to repair the dialysis at the same time. Or the presence of a sphincter tear, which your patient might have, then patient would have a postoperative glare or halos because of the sphincter tear. Then you have to counsel before surgery. And gonioscopy in certain cases, where especially in closed group injuries and chronic cases, where you are suspecting the pass or the suspecting angle recession, and you might need a glaucoma filtration surgery later or at the time of your primary cataract removal. So you can plan after, if you are planning for that, you can do gonio also along with that. Then a lens examination, which is very important, then you have to first look for the capsular integrity. If the capsule is intact, then we can proceed like normally we do 360 degree corneal capsulosis. But if the capsular tear is present, anterior capsular tear is present, then first you have to try for a 360 degree CCC. But if it is not possible, then you trim the edges of the tears along with the Vanna scissor so that they don't get entangled in your instrument while doing aspiration or removing the cataract surgery, and try to avoid the ending dialysis of the capsule. And another thing is the amount of cataract. Like if the patient can have a total like a soft cataract where you don't need a cutting, you only need aspiration, or like in old patients with trauma, patient can have a senile component also. So according to that, you have to change your phaco parameters. And the third thing is phacodynesis. Phacodynesis is basically gives you a clue about the jonular dehiscence or jonular injury. So you have to be prepared on the OT table along with your iris hooks or your capsular hooks to support the capsule. And the amount of subluxation and dislocation, depending upon the quadrantic subluxation and dislocation, you have to prepare for either CTR or Fionn's ring or SFIR. Then posterior segment evaluation, if your media is clear enough and you can see the posterior segment, then you either you can do it direct and we preferably do indirect. So you can do the optic disc and macular evaluation and up to the periphery with indirect ophthalmoscope. And if the media is not clear enough, then you can plan the ultrasound by microscopy, like to look for the posterior capsular integrity or for the ciliary body condition. Or you can do ultrasound B scan to look for the retinal status. X-ray and CT scan in certain cases where you are suspecting intraocular foreign body or you are suspecting orbital fracture, then you can ask for X-ray orbit or CT scan in this. This is also another thing, choice of anesthesia. We prefer basically general anesthesia in patients of trauma, but and the choice depends upon either it's whether it's an open case or a closed loop trauma case. In open case, generally we don't give peri-vulvar injection, but if there is no choice, then you can give 5 mL peri-vulvar injection and then you can give further subtenon injection to add on your anesthesia. Try to avoid massaging in these eyes when there is an open globe. Age of the patient, generally pediatric and younger patient, they require general anesthesia. Health status is the patient in condition, like whether it's fit for anesthesia or not. Another thing is estimated duration of procedure. If you are thinking that the procedure will be a long thing, it will be a multiple procedure at the same time, then better to do it under general anesthesia. And surgeon comfort is the last thing. But whatever you feel comfort and the things are available, then you can go ahead with the anesthesia training. So finally, concluding my remarks, that traumatic cataract is usually we are seeing in our OPD routinely, and it's a very common case of ocular morbidity in younger patients and pediatric patients. And they are most of the times they are associated with other injuries, like ocular other structures are involved. So that need a thorough evaluation at the time of presentation. And preoperative evaluation is must to determine the best surgical plan to ensure satisfactory and best visual outcome to these patients. Thank you.